So we were standing at 90 meters or something.
Yeah,
and
yeah. Like 86, 87 is.
Zoals elke deftige wereldstad moet ook Gdansk zijn naam in reuze letters ergens hebben op een herkenbare plaats. Deze letters hier achter mij zijn zeker 2 meter hoog. En zoals u kunt zien is het een dankbaar speeltuig voor de kindjes. Het zijn geen orgelpijpen, maar het geeft wel die indruk. En het is ook zo bedoeld, want er staat ook een kerkorgelkeyboard en zelfs fragmenten van een partituur. De ligging is ook niet toevallig. Het is aan Polska Philharmonica en behuist de Chopin Federatie of het Chopin Gezelschap of Genootschap, of hoe dat mag heten.
We zijn in Gdansk, Belgische friet. Het is een marketingstunt.
Een Belgische frituur.
Goedemorgen. We staan er in Gdansk, nog steeds. Het hotel is hier vlakbij, dus aan de waterkant. Hier achter mij zit hier het Q Hotel in Gdansk. Het hotel waar ik 3 nachten zal verblijven. Het televisieaanbod is beperkt. Er zijn maar enkele Duitsstalige zenders en de rest is allemaal Pools en nog exotischer talen. Het ontbijt wordt op een vreemde manier geserveerd. Je komt dus 2 meter van het buffet vandaan en dan moet je een open instructies geven wat je wil hebben. Je zegt dus van hoeveel boterhammen, welk soort broodjes, welk soort beleg en welk warm ontbijt enzovoort. Dus. En dan kan je dat zelf meenemen naar je plaats die dus pas gedekt wordt als je de plaats gekozen hebt. Gdansk heeft ook zijn reuzenrad en ik ben er nog niet in geweest, ik ben het ook niet van plan. Er is hier een voetgangersbrug over dit kanaal, over deze wateruitweg. Blijkbaar krijgen alle boten ongeveer 1 uur doorgang 's avonds. En dat wordt eerst dus met een stem in Engels, Duits en waarschijnlijk ook Pools de mensen aangemaand om de brug te verlaten. Dan gaat de brug naar boven. Amai, die gaat rap. En zo snel kan het dus gaan dat de brug open is. Ik was net begonnen met oversteken en ik hoorde al zo'n luidsprekerstem. Ik hoop dat het op de video te horen zal zijn. Dus. En ze is weer naar boven, dus blijkbaar gaat ze dus elk uur open als een schip het vraagt. En het wordt een warme dag, dus er zijn toch veel schippers die uitvaren. En dan blijven er de hele tijd grote boten en kleine boten doorvaren tot de brug weer terug naar beneden gaat. Het is nu zondagochtend en de brug staat open. Blijkbaar is er een soort van vast uurschema. Maar op zondagochtend zijn ook de schippers langslapers. Er is niemand aan het doorvaren. Terwijl het gisteravond een drukte van je welste was. Als de brug open is, kan je dus niet verder wandelen. En wordt je dus hier tegengehouden door het hek. Gisteravond nog een pianoconcert meegepikt. Maar het concert werd niet in de hal zelf gedaan, maar eigenlijk in de lobby. Waar dat men dan dus een piano had opgesteld en stoelen op 2 meter uit elkaar. De Onyx is zich aan het klaarmaken voor vertrek. Dus die is achter mij aan het uitvaren. En dus die gaat dus de brug passeren. Ik neem mijn woorden terug. De Onyx is net uitgevaren. Dat is een van de grotere schepen die hier in de haven ligt. En blijkbaar zit hier dus een zondagochtend vol mensen aan boord voor een excursie. Dat is het geluidssignaal dat men de brug naar beneden gaat laten gaan. Dus er is dus een alarmsignaal als de brug in beweging is. wordt het hek dus geopend voor de voetgangers die al klaarstaan om over te steken. Vanop het midden van de brug naar de stad. Er ligt daar zo'n oud houten piratenschip en daarmee worden ook korte excursies gedaan. Als het een rivier zou zijn, dan staan we nu op rechteroever in Gdansk. Hier achter mij ligt een heel uitgebreide jachthaven met hier dichterbij de professionele excursieschepen, zeg maar alle soorten van Flandria-schepen, inclusief zo'n nagebouwd piratenschip in hout. Die maakt dan wel een hele korte excursie, want die is gisteravond op minder dan een uur en buiten gevaren en terug binnen gevaren. Want de brug die is maar beperkt open, dus de voetgangersbrug. Alleen de hele kleine schepen kunnen onder de brug door, maar de van zo gauw als het een iets wat deftig jacht, en zeker de zeiljachten, die hebben de open brug nodig. Achter mij ziet u dus dat houten piratenschip. Daarop worden kortlopende excursies georganiseerd. Op een uur is die zowel naar buiten gevaren als naar binnen gevaren, want die heeft dus de open brug nodig en die is maar beperkt open. Hier achter mij liggen nog wat van de historische schepen. Het stalen schip aan deze oever is een museumschip. Dat vaart dus niet meer uit. Ik vermoed dat het met de Poolse zeemacht te maken heeft gehad.
Zelfs hier hebben ze het begrepen, de berenzoektocht tijdens de coronacrisis.
Hier moet je wel aanschuiven, maar dit is geen 2 meter per koppel. No way.
So welcome all of you in a lovely, beautiful, sunny morning in a beautiful city of Gdansk. My name is Martin.
De andere kant van het Ambermuseum.
De toren staat aan de overkant.
If it's difficult to get in, it's also difficult to get out. This is prison tower, this is chamber of torture. They converted it in complete facilities for court of justice. They enlarged both buildings, so they built more cells up there, and they built 2 floors to have court of justice in this building. But in this part of Europe, it is still late Renaissance, so-called mannerism, and that's the style of this gate. And the backside was decorated in the 19th century, 1884. And this is why up there in the middle, you can see coat of arm of Hohenzollern Prussian dynasty. For those who enter the city, the message is simple. You enter the city of Gdansk, we are part of Royal Prussia, and we are proud to be ruled by Polish king. Although people living here, majority of them were German-speaking people. I do not call them Germans, I do not call them Polish, yet. Since 14th century, the gate behind me was just ugly, defending Gothic gate. But as the western border was moved further to the west, and further to the west, there was no need to have ugly, defending Gothic gate here. So at the beginning of 17th century, they changed the gate into this beautiful, representative entrance. Okay, so now we are inside the city. And the message here is the message for those who live inside. The first one on my right hand, she holds lunette and sun clock. It is prudentia, prudence. Lunette, to look far away, to predict the future, and clock, not to waste the time. The next one holds the big book that's the Bible. It is pietas, piety. The next one, that's the easiest one, she holds scale, that's common symbol of justice, that's justitia, justice. And the last one on my left, she holds arrows. In the right hand, she holds a set of arrows, and in the left hand, she holds a single broken arrow. That's concordia, concord. It's better to stay together than to fight with arrows. And this symbolic of concord is repeated below with Latin sentence, which says, with concord, small countries rise. With discord, large countries collapse. And this Teutonic period lasts for 150 years, since the beginning of 14th century until mid-15th century. And in that time, the city, the main town of Gdansk, was very much developing. And the development of the city was related with being part of Hanseatic League. That was an association of German harbors established in 12th century, and in 14th century, main town of Gdansk joins Hanseatic League, and is very profitable for the city. The city gets wealthier and wealthier and a bit wealthier. At the beginning of 15th century, Poland started to run war against Teutonic Knights. And whenever I say Poland, from this time until the end of 18th century, I mean the Commonwealth of the Kingdom of Poland and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The name is very long. I cut it into Poland.
Dat is de achterkant dan van dat arsenaal wat door de Hollanders is ontworpen. Dus het is veel minder fraai versierd, maar toch.
A few words about the church. The church is huge, so I prepared small model for you. St. Mary's Basilica had been built for 160 years. It was the largest church in the city of Gdansk. Its capacity was estimated to 25,000 people standing. So since 10th century, there was Christianity brought here, and that was Catholic Christianity. And the first 500 years, all churches were built as Catholic churches, Gothic Catholic churches. And 500 years ago, there was coming out made by Martin Luther. And very quickly, the first Protestant priest came to Gdansk, and very quickly, majority of citizens converted into Protestants. From the late 16th century until the end of 19th century, the belief structure in the city has not changed. 70% were Lutherans, 20% were Roman Catholics, and a few percent were Calvinists. The city was very multicultural, multinational. So outside the city, we had districts for Jews, for Mennonites from the Netherlands, Scots, Englishmen. The situation changed in the 19th century under Prussian authority. Then everyone could live inside the city. And in late 19th century, the great Jewish synagogue was built inside the city. The synagogue survived until 1939. After the Second World War, after complete conversion of people living here, 95% of people are Roman Catholics.
En als je het breed hemt, laat je het breed hangen, vergulde spitsen alom.
People living here were awfully wealthy and they wanted to show off. They were Protestants, so they were not supposed to show off, but they still wanted, so they started to change facades of their houses. So since until 16th century, most houses looked like Gothic facades, but since 16th century they start to build Renaissance facades, like for instance the one in front of me, with lots of decoration, lots of sculptures, lots of symbolics. Yeah, at my left hand you can see the main town hall. Yeah, so there is a little bit of shade options. They were German speaking Protestants, not Polish or Lithuanian speaking Catholics. But they were proud to be part of Poland and they put statues of Polish king at the top of the tower. And one more thing, the top of this tower is covered with gold. Because we can afford it, that's simple, shining gold. From a far distance, you can see that you approach a wealthy city of that. A bit of vanity? No, pure vanity. So the name comes from the legend of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. So citizens of Gdansk created this court as a gathering place. If there were any feasts given in the city, they were given in the Arthur's court. People were gathering inside, sitting at the big round table, making business, having meal, later just making business, because from 18th century it was converted into first stock exchange in this part of Europe. A wealthy merchant wanted to have absolutely the most beautiful house in the city. So he ordered from Italian architect in Italy two facades, front and backside facade of his house. And this Italian architect made these two facades in Italy, put it on two separate ships and shipped it to Gdansk. Unfortunately, one ship sank. And that was the one with the front facade. So he decided to install this ugly backside facade on the front of his house. Do you know the face? Do you know the name? Daniel Gabriel Fahrenheit. Fahrenheit was a son of a wealthy merchant family. He becomes famous physicist. He invented Fahrenheit scale and thermometer with mercury. This is why we have thermometer instead of monument. They supported Polish king. How? They lent him money. In a revenge, Polish king issued so-called the Great Privilege. And the Great Privilege that was the source of wealth of the city. It created enormous independence. But what's most important, there were economic privileges related to the harbor. Anyone who wants to trade in this harbor must use local merchants. These guys produced nothing and were making good money. you can see that in front of every single house there is the beautiful terrace, decorative stairs, and these dragon heads. These dragon heads have a very fancy name. They are called these stairs, and these pukas were in front of every single house in the main town of Gdansk. As you remember, the source of wealth for the city, that was being part of Poland. That was Vistula trade, that was Polish king's privileges. And Poland is gone, Polish king is gone, Polish king's privileges are gone, profits are gone. One of these wealthy merchant family lived in a house 111-113. The house is called Under the Turtle.
In dit huis had bovenaan zijn gevel een schildpad als versiering.
And a few decades later, small Arthur becomes big Arthur. Ta-da! And that's the next famous citizen of Gdansk. That's Arthur Schopenhauer, famous philosopher. His philosophy was rather pessimistic, so I call him the largest pessimist in the city.
Dat is een los- en laadtoren met telkens overhangende stukken waardoor men dan een kraan en een kabel naar beneden kon laten.
And because of having this wide street, at the end of the street they decided to create the Great Crane. The Great Crane was built in 14th century. It was built between two defending towers. It was built of timber. And with nowadays shape, it was the largest harbor crane in medieval Europe. Each hook could lift up to 2 tons. If you combine them, you could lift 4 tons. It was used to lift heavy items from the river and transport it outside the city by this wide street. These pair of wheels, that's the engine for lower hook. The same pair of wheels is above as the engine for upper hook. You know, either you carry a heavy bag on the shoulder or you work there. 4 people walking each wheel, 4 wheels, altogether 16 people walking here to move this train work. The monument is called For Those Who Died for Polish Gdansk. And there are different dates, and all of these dates are only the dates when there was conflict between Poland and Teutonic Knights or Poland and Germany. According to my best knowledge, that was the most Nazi city in Europe. I mean, in neither German city, the Nazis received higher support in parliament election than 64% here in Gdansk in 1935.
En daar is het oude postkantoor annex school.
On the 1st of September at 4:45 a.m. German battleship Schleswig-Holstein strikes against Westerplatte. Westerplatte, that's a military Polish military base in the harbor. German battleship strikes early in the morning. This is 4 kilometers from here. You can hear it. Exactly the same moment with the first shots from Westerplatte, fully armed SS and SA troops and local police start attack on this building. We know when and we know where. 1st of September, 4:45, Westerplatte, and here. 2 spots where the first shots of the Second World War took place. The guys are waiting for the soldiers to rescue them. They have no idea that nobody's gonna come because Westerplatte is on fire. They keep on defending the building. At 4 p.m., there was a big fire brigade car approaching the building, start to pump petrol to the basement and set fire. At 6 p.m., after nearly 14 hours of defense, they have no choice just to give up. So the first one to go out is the first chief officer, who goes out with white flag and is immediately shot here. The next one is vice chief officer, who goes out with white flag and yes, he was shot, but before he was burnt with flame gun. 6 people tried to escape. 4 managed to escape and they survived the war. 2 were captured and shot. All the others decide to give up together. And all of them were placed against that wall. My left hand, you can see a picture taken by German propaganda on this day with people having Christ hands. And on the wall, you can see the symbolical fingerprints of people standing there. All of these postmen were arrested. Within 1 week, there was quick, fake, artificial trial. All of them were sentenced to death. At the beginning of October 1939, all of them were shot. They died because they were Polish. There was no military, no tactical, no strategic reason for attacking this building, killing these people.
We gaan toch een boottochtje doen. De brug is open op dit moment. Blijkbaar is het dus een half uur per uur dat de brug open is. We zijn dus ingescheept op zeg maar de lokale Flandriaboot voor een rondje in Gdansk.
The pirate ship is going to hit us. Because there are two stops on the right.
Thank you, bye bye.
Thank you, bye.
The last shot on the dashboard.